Welcome to the wonderful world of the Amiga computer from Commodore. This powerful personal computer can open up thousands of new opportunities for you in business, education, entertainment, and creative arenas. As personal computers continue to find new uses in our homes and businesses, the Amiga is perhaps one of the most flexible and easy to learn, while at the same time providing power beyond that of most competitors. For our introduction to the Amiga, we will discuss software and hardware. In almost every case, the instruction will give you insight into using your Amiga, regardless of which model you use. If we come upon a specific solution for a single Amiga model, we'll let you know. Now, let's get those boxes unpacked and take a better look at each component prior to putting everything together. For this example, we'll use an Amiga 500 system. Later on, we'll show you how to assemble an Amiga 2000 series system as well. Don't worry, you won't need a mechanics toolkit or any aspirin. The Amiga 500 contains all of the principal components that make up the computer. Called the main unit, you'll plug in all of the various peripherals you purchased to this central operating center. The main unit of the Amiga 500 includes a keyboard, a disk drive, the Amiga processing system called the CPU, or Central Processing Unit, some memory, graphics, and sound chips, and an expansion slot for future hardware additions. In the back of the unit, you'll find a number of connectors for plugging in peripheral devices, such as external disk drives, printers, and telephone modems. If we've lost you already, don't worry. We'll explain everything in a few minutes. Unpack the power supply. There are two cables coming out of the power supply. This end connects the unit to the Amiga, while the other end plugs into the power socket in your wall. In the packaging for the main unit, you'll also find a device with a long cable attached to it. This is the mouse. We'll talk a lot about mice, or specifically your mouse, as this video continues. In another box, you'll find the monitor display for the Amiga. There are a number of different monitors available for the Amiga, but for this video, we'll use the monitor offered by Commodore. This monitor looks very similar to a television monitor. It includes jacks for plugging in computer signals, stereo sound, and video. You may have purchased some other components as well, including a disk drive, a printer, or a modem. We'll discuss all of them as we proceed, but for now, we're going to discuss the assembly of a basic Amiga 500 system. When working with computers, it's a common wish to get started as quickly as possible. Some people will jump right in, forgetting to read the instruction guides that come with the computers. We suggest that you read through your Amiga user's guide for information on getting set up and using the operating system. Before actually connecting anything, it's a good idea to check and make sure that everything is turned off. For those of you that purchased additional memory, your first step is to insert the A501 memory unit into the bottom of the CPU. The memory board is sensitive and comes packaged in a static-proof container. Follow the instructions in the user's guide. Remove the cover of the memory slot, then carefully insert the memory board onto the slotted connector. Don't force it, but do use some pressure. Once it's snug in the connector, replace the cover onto the bottom of the unit. Next, attach the RGB monitor. You may want to mount it on the rear deck of the Amiga, but it would be a bit better if you could find a place next to or behind the unit so the monitor is on a stable surface. Now, before moving any further, let's make sure we have several items available to us while we learn how to use the computer. You will need the Commodore User Guide, the workbench disk, several blank disks, a pen and paper for taking some notes. Before you power up the computer for the first time, it's a good idea to check all of the connections to make sure there isn't anything loose or improperly attached. Once you're sure that everything is properly set up, you can flip the power switch. Within a moment or two, an image will appear on the screen of your monitor. If nothing happens, check to make sure that you've turned the monitor on. The display will show a computer disk and the word workbench. Once the workbench is loaded, you will see a display that looks like this. This is the workbench environment, and we'll learn a lot about workbench in a few moments. Sometimes, when powering up the computer, the monitor display will look too dark or fuzzy. There are a number of adjustments you can make to ensure a clear picture. The brightness control and the contrast control adjust the visual display. It's a good idea to try to keep both controls as close to the middle or neutral position as possible. Too much contrast or too much brightness isn't good for your vision. The Amiga uses 3.5-inch floppy disks to store data. These disks have become the standard size in the computer industry and are widely available from a number of sources. The disks the Amiga uses are double-sided. That means they store information on both sides of the disk. Graphics take up much more room. Often, you'll be able to completely fill up a disk with a single page of graphics. For those of us who require large amounts of information, there are expanded disk drives, called hard disks. These storage devices can hold the same amount of information as 20, 30, or even 100 floppy disks. Yet they are in a small, highly portable box like this one. One of the pet peeves of computer users is that regardless of the computer they use, sometimes an instruction will cause the computer to become confused and to lock up. This is called crashing. When the computer crashes, all the data in its memory is usually lost, although the information on your disk will remain okay. The Amiga provides the user with a message indicating the type of problem. The Amiga uses a clever term called guru to signify the error. If you ever encounter a guru or cannot otherwise get the Amiga to perform, you will need to reset or reboot the computer. To do this, simply depress three keys on your Amiga keyboard at once, the left and right Amiga key and the control key. In the past, to get your computer to do something, you needed to know the specific sequence of commands to type. There was no information to assist you. During the past few years, using computers has become more interactive, with controls and functions available to you as a computer user in understandable terms. Today, the user interface has been designed to make computing direct, with easy-to-understand visual clues and tools for you to use. The interface used by the Amiga is called the workbench. Think of it as a workspace for all of your in-progress projects. The workbench will allow you to view the contents of any disk, organize your programs and data, prepare new disks for data or format them, copy files from one disk to another, access programs and utilities. Before we move into the actual operations of the computer, we should explain one more function of the workbench and the Amiga. Because the Amiga is a graphical computer, there is a lot of emphasis on the screen and anything that's displayed on it. Screens are made up of several important attributes, including the resolution, referring to the number of pixels or little dots the computer can display either vertically or horizontally at once. Depending on the resolution selected, the number of usable colors will change as well. There are a variety of modes available, from 16 to 32 colors, all the way up to 4,096 colors in a specialized display mode called Hold and Modify, or HAM. Because the Amiga is graphics and video oriented, the computer will also support a video mode called Interlace. This mode doubles the number of horizontal display lines and displays half of them at a time, cycling the lines at a 30th of a second. This is the same method used by television. Now's a good time to explain some of the visual aids provided by the interactive workbench environment. Now that the workbench is loaded, you'll notice that in addition to the icons on the screen, there is an object that looks like a little arrow. This is called the mouse pointer. As you move the mouse of your Amiga, this little object will move around the screen. The mouse pointer is very powerful, as it will allow you to execute various commands without typing on the Amiga keyboard. The tip of the pointer is the actuating area of the pointer. And when you are using the pointer, make sure the tip is on top of anything that you want to use or select. The workbench screen includes several different types of objects. These include a bar across the top of the screen. Depending on its function, it's referred to as a menu bar, drag bar, or title bar. In every case, the bar will provide information to you, in addition to supporting a multiple menu system for making operational decisions and positioning the screen. More on this later. Next, there are icons. An icon is a graphical representation of either a disk, a program, a data file, or a drawer. Drawers are unique to the Amiga workbench. They function in the same manner as the drawers of a filing cabinet. You can separate your programs or data into separate compartments. This will make keeping track of your work easy. A window represents a partition of information. For example, if you wanted to see what is on a disk, you will see a window of the information on a disk. If you wanted to open a drawer of data, the contents of the drawer will be displayed in a window. The window can provide some valuable information to you. For example, notice the colored gauge on the left side of the window. It's called a memory meter. It's kind of like a gas gauge in your car. It shows you how much room is left on the disk you're displaying. There are some other controls on the window called gadgets. We'll discuss them a bit later on. Let's take a brief look at the different types of icons available to you. First of all, there is the disk icon. This represents any disks that are loaded into the Amiga's disk drives. A disk icon could also represent a hard disk or a RAM disk. If we position the mouse on top of the disk icon and click the mouse once, it'll change color. This means the icon has been selected and it's now ready to be accessed. There are a number of ways you could do this. For now, let's click the mouse twice quickly and the disk will open up and display the window of contents on the Amiga screen. There are four types of icons now visible. The first ones to consider are the drawer icons. These look like drawers in a dresser and contain programs, data, or even other drawers of information. For example, there is a drawer with the Amiga operating system, a drawer with the Amiga utilities, another with demonstration programs, and an empty drawer, just waiting for you to put something in it. The other icons are also important. These include the trash can icon, the preferences icon, and the clock icon. If you want to erase something from the disk or from the computer's memory, you place the file or program in the trash. This is a perfect example of the interactive nature of the workbench. The preferences icon allows you to adjust the display and functionality of the Amiga. We'll discuss using it a bit later. Finally, the clock icon is effectively the least important one, but it can be useful. By selecting it, you can see what time it is. You can move icons anywhere you'd like on the screen. Simply position the pointer over the icon, hold the right mouse button down, and drag the mouse to the position you want the icon to be in. For example, if you want to put a program into a drawer, drag it until the icon is positioned on top of the drawer and release the mouse button. As you become more familiar with the Amiga, you'll need to begin using the Windows often. In order to learn all about Windows, double-click the mouse on top of the disk icon in the upper right corner of the Amiga screen. The window includes the memory meter, a bar across the top called a drag bar, and some controls called gadgets. A gadget is like a switch. By selecting it, a specific function will occur. Once again, this is a good demonstration of the power of the workbench. The first gadget to learn about is the close gadget. On a window, you can find it in the upper left-hand corner. As its name suggests, the close gadget is used to close a window. Simply position the pointer over the close gadget and click the left button of the mouse once. Instantly, the window will disappear. To reopen the window, simply click on its originating icon, in this case, the disk icon. In the upper right-hand corner of the window is a pair of gadgets called the back and front gadgets. These are used to position the window in the screen. If you have more than one window open, things can get confusing, so to better control the windows, you can move them around using these gadgets. Notice that the title bar at the top of the screen also has a front and back gadget. These will be used if you are multitasking, and we'll explain a bit about that a little later. In the right hand and bottom margins of the window are the scroll bar gadgets. These allow you to move the contents of the window and resize the physical size of the windows themselves. One of the first things to learn about now that we have the basics of the screen under control is disks. These fellows are the critical link between your computer and your programs and information. If you lose the information on a disk, you'll need to reassemble the data from scratch. One of the wonderful things about computers is that you can copy almost anything from one disk to another. It's a good idea to copy certain disks before you use them. That way, should something unforetold occur, you'll have a spare or a backup available for keeping your project on schedule. Number of programs available for specialized or high-speed copying, but for this first try, we'll use the workbench to copy a disk. This method isn't the fastest, but it's reliable, and it's part of the workbench environment. During the course of learning about copying disks, you'll also learn about menus and request stores. For this example, we'll make a backup of the actual workbench disk. To begin, be sure you have the workbench disk and a blank disk. In this case, our workbench disk is already in the disk drive. Position the pointer over the workbench disk. Click the left mouse button once. The disk will change color, indicating it has been selected. Now move the pointer to the menu bar and depress the right button. This button, by the way, is referred to as the menu button. The menu bar will now show three options, including workbench, disk, and special. Move the pointer until it's over the workbench option. Once there, a panel of additional options will appear. This panel is called a pull-down menu. Move the pointer down the list until it's over the word duplicate. Release the menu button of the mouse. A box will appear on the screen of the computer. This is called a requestor. Requesters will appear any time a decision must be made. At this point, the workbench disk is already in the drive, so you can click on Continue. If you didn't have the right disk, the requester would ask you to replace the source disk, called a volume, with the destination disk. You will see an icon appear on the screen called DFO Busy. At the same time, a requester will appear. This requester is making sure that you've executed the right sequence of events. If you put the wrong disk in, this requester would give you a chance to make a change. Anytime you want to undo what you've done, you can select the gadget labeled Cancel. In this case, we've done the right thing. The correct source disk is in the drive, therefore we'll select the gadget labeled Continue. Immediately, the Amiga will begin reading in the contents of the source volume. After a few moments, the drive will stop, and a requester will ask you to remove the source volume and insert the blank volume you want the data copied to. Remove the workbench disk and insert your blank. Make sure the Write Protect tab is open. Make sure that you are inserting the right disk. If you make a mistake and insert the wrong disk, everything on it will be destroyed. So double-check everything before you proceed. Click the pointer on the Continue button. The Amiga will complete making the duplicate workbench disk. When the copying process is complete, the second disk will appear on the workbench labeled Copy of Workbench. Thank you. next step is to learn how to prepare a blank disk for accepting programs or data. You'll need some place to store the information you're going to create. As every computer on the market uses a slightly different system for storing information, the process of preparing or formatting a blank disk is different with every computer. Begin by removing the disk that's in the drive. Take a blank disk and insert it into the drive. The disk motor will function for a moment or two, and an icon will appear on the workbench. The icon will be labeled DFO Bad. The word bad is there because the Amiga cannot read the disk. Select the disk to be formatted. Move the pointer up to the menu bar and depress the menu button on the mouse. Position the pointer over the disk option, and when the pull-down menu appears, move the pointer down to the word Initialize. A request door will appear asking you to replace the disk to be formatted with the workbench disk. Don't worry, nothing is wrong. You won't erase the workbench disk. The requester is asking you to insert the workbench disk so the Amiga can read the code for formatting disks. Once the Amiga has read the information on formatting, another requester will appear. Replace the workbench disk with the blank disk. And yet another requestor will appear, asking if it's okay to go ahead and format the disk. If it is, then click the mouse while over the continue gadget. Once the disk is completely formatted, the disk will appear with the name empty. Congratulations, you've completed a valuable lesson, getting your Amiga up and running, identifying the important components of the system, and learning the basic fundamentals about the workbench is vital to understanding how your Amiga functions. Now, it's time to start using the workbench. During the past few minutes, you got the opportunity to learn a little bit about the menu bar. Now, let's take a closer look at the menu bar and how it works in Workbench. The menu bar is an important function in nearly all Amiga software programs. Once you learn how to use it in the Workbench, you'll understand what to look for, no matter which Amiga program you use. The commands found in the menu bar and the accompanying pull-down menus will change with every program you use. The commands found in the menu bar while running Workbench are all oriented towards the Amiga itself and the use of disks. The first is the Open command. Position the pointer over the disk and click the selection button once. The disk is selected. Move the pointer up to the menu bar and go to the Workbench option. Slide the pointer down until it's positioned over the Open command. When you release the selection button, the disk will open and a window will appear. The Close command is similar to the Close gadget on all Windows. Make sure the window you want is selected and position the pointer over Close. You can change the name of any disk using the Rename command. Select the disk you want to rename. Position the cursor over Rename and release the menu button. A message will appear on the menu bar that reads, Enter the new name. Press Return when done. At the same time, a frame will appear in the center of the screen with the name of the disk centered in it. This is called a string gadget. The term string refers to more than one character at a time. The far right character will be reverse colored to indicate it is the selected character. You can erase a character by using the delete key on the Amiga keyboard. Once you have erased the unwanted characters, simply type in the new name you want on the keyboard. And when you're finished, hit return. And voila, you've changed names. The info command is very useful. It can provide valuable information about a disk or a program. Select the item you want to get information on. In this case, it'll be the workbench disk. Now move the pointer to the word info in the pull-down menu. A new window, called the info window, will appear. In the window, you will see information on the disk, including the name of the disk, the type of object selected, how much information can be stored in the object, or how large in size it is, the default tool information, tool types, and the status of the object. We'll discuss tools and tool types a bit later. Close the info window. You can either select the close menu option or click the pointer on the quit gadget in the lower right-hand corner of the window. Discard menu option will allow you to eliminate unwanted files, programs, drawers, and tools. You can use this command in much the same manner as the open command, but be careful. You cannot recover anything that you discard. There is another way to eliminate unwanted files. You can use the trash can icon on the workbench screen. Simply drag the unwanted item until it is positioned over the trash can icon. Once you've released the selection button on the mouse, the unwanted file will be placed in the trash. Initially, you can recover something placed in the trash by opening the trash icon, by double-clicking on it, or by using the open command. Now, once you're sure you want to eliminate the items placed in the trash, you can empty the trash by selecting the pull-down menu item, Empty Trash. After you have moved a number of items around on the workbench screen, you may want to organize the visual appearance of the screen. You can use the cleanup command to do this. Simply select the drawer or disk you want cleaned up. Now, select the cleanup command from the pull-down menu. If you were to shut the Amiga down, the reorganization would not be remembered. In order to permanently keep the new organized display, you must use the snapshot command. To do this, you must first select all of the items you want permanently recorded in their new position. You can select more than one item at a time. To do this, depress the left or right shift key prior to selecting an object. Then, while continuing to depress the shift key, select all the items you want. Once you have selected everything you want recorded, select the snapshot command from the pull-down menu. Software is constantly being improved. Often a publisher will make revisions to a program several times in a single year. In order to keep track of these improvements, they will encode a version number in the program. The workbench is no different than any other program in this regard. In order to see which version of the workbench you are using, select the version command. Not only will it display the version of the workbench, but it will also inform you as to the version of the Kickstart ROM in your Amiga. Double-click the selection button over the clock icon to display the time. Once displayed, you may drag the clock window anywhere on the screen you'd like. You may also resize the clock using the size gadget. You can also use the clock as an alarm. Use the right mouse button to display the pull-down menu options and select Alarm. Then select Set. A requester will appear with the time displayed and a choice of up or down arrows. Use these arrows to select the time you want the alarm to activate. Once you've selected the correct time for the alarm, click the left mouse button over the Use button. If you decide you don't want to use the alarm, you can always select Cancel. To activate the alarm, select Alarm On in the Alarm menu. You can turn the alarm off by selecting Alarm Off in the Alarm menu or by closing the clock window. Double-click on the Notepad icon. The Notepad and Notepad fonts will load into the Amiga's memory and a window for entering text will appear. You may want to use the Notepad for keeping track of simple messages or information on where you've put files in your computer. The Notepad is a mini word processing program. If you don't plan on using a word processor for more than single or double page letters, the Notepad may provide enough power for you. It includes multiple fonts, tabs, editing tools, search commands, and more. To enter text, make sure the Notepad window is active. To do this, look at the letters in the menu bar. If they are dimmed, the Notepad is not active. To activate it, click anywhere on the window once. To deactivate it, click anywhere on the workbench window once. Once the Notepad is activated, you may begin typing. If you want to tab, press the Tab key on your keyboard. The tabs are predefined, with one tab every 8 characters. As with other programs, you can resize the Notepad with the size gadget. By the way, one of the nice things about the Amiga workbench environment is the structure of tools and gadgets. Once you've learned how a gadget works in one program, it'll probably work the same way in another. Once you've filled the Notepad window with text, the scroll gadgets will activate and the text will begin scrolling. Two other gadgets will appear, the previous and next page gadgets. These allow you to move quickly through a document you've created. The Notepad has 5 pull-down menus, including Project, Edit, Font, Style, and Format. These menus include the standard word processing functions. You are limited in the Notepad regarding the number of lines you may type. As different fonts take up different amounts of memory, you may type from 80 to 163 lines. The calculator is a valuable tool that allows you to make simple computations while using the Amiga. Double-click on the calculator icon to open it. A window will appear. Position it wherever you like on the screen of your monitor. Each of the buttons in the calculator window is a gadget. To use them, either click the mouse on each gadget or type the corresponding number or letter on your Amiga keyboard. When you want a total, you may type either the equal key, the return key, or the enter key. Did you know your Amiga could talk? Using the Say Speech synthesizer, you can enter in words or phrases, and the Amiga will repeat them. Double-click on the Say icon. 2 windows will appear. One is an input window, where you will type the words and phrases you want the Amiga to say. The other window is the phoneme window. This window displays the phonetic interpretation of what you want the Amiga to say.
I love my Amiga.
Graphic Dump allows you to print the entire screen, including menus and icons, to your printer. To execute a graphic dump, double-click on the icon. Then you have approximately 10 seconds to arrange everything on the screen, because that's the way it'll be printed. The display that you see when the Amiga is booted is not the only option available to you. In fact, the Amiga has been designed to provide you with many options to suit your personal tastes and needs. There are 2 types of personalization available to you. These include software and hardware. Of course, software means you can design screens and colors to your preference. As for hardware, you can add any number of peripheral devices for use in engineering, publishing, or video work. Right now, we'll discuss the software options. Later on, the hardware peripherals. When you first start using your Amiga, you'll notice that the screen is a certain color and that the mouse moves at a specific speed. When you open the Workbench disk, the Preferences tool is visible on the screen. Select it. Before explaining specific operations, let's take a brief tour of the Preferences program. In the lower left corner of the screen are 3 sliders for red, green, and blue, or RGB as it's called. These sliders are used to change the color of the Amiga screen during Workbench or CLI operations. Above these sliders are several toggle gadgets, including one for the CLI, the number of columns available for text, operation of the serial port, and the date and time. In the upper left corner are 2 important gadgets. These allow you to load the most recently saved preferences file or to reset the preferences to the factory settings. In the center of the screen is a representation of the Amiga computer screen. You can adjust the position of the screen here. Above that is a pair of sliders for adjusting the key repeat and delay speeds. To the right of the screen, you can adjust the display of the Amiga, the speed of the mouse, and you can change printers. Finally, the preferences you create can be saved for permanent use, temporarily used, or canceled. This is one of the easiest changes to make. Simply click the mouse on the digit you want to change, and then use the up and down arrows to make the adjustments. Everybody has a different typing speed. We also tend to apply a different amount of pressure on the keyboard when typing. For example, if you've been used to a manual typewriter, you'll probably strike each key with more force, as you would the old manual keys of that IBM. Now you can adjust the speed with which the keys will repeat. Simply drag the slider to the left or right, left being slow, right being fast. The same is true of the delay time. Be careful to set a realistic time for each of these. If you find that you're making quite a few mistakes, but you feel that you're using the proper keys, check preferences. You may have created some unrealistic settings for your own use. Another speed control is for the mouse. When moving the mouse on a tabletop, the pointer will move or react at a specific speed. You may feel a need to change that. To do so, simply drag the slider in much the same manner as you would for the keyboard. If you're using a monitor larger than 20 inches, You will probably want to speed up the mouse speed so you won't have to pick up the mouse and relocate it during long moves. The double-click slider will adjust the time between the clicks on the mouse. Since the Amiga can be used with a normal television or an RGB monitor, the appearance of text must be adjustable. If you're using a standard television, select 60 lines across. If, on the other hand, you're using an RGB monitor, such as the Amiga monitor, select 80 characters across. The Amiga has two operating environments, including the workbench and the CLI. Although most people will use the workbench, some will want to enable the CLI. Simply select which position you want to use. To center the video image in your monitor, place the mouse pointer over the angle in the center section of the display centering gadget. Holding down the selection button, you can drag the angle and the display around until the position suits you. The serial port on the back of your Amiga can be used for a number of things. As most of today's printers are usually hooked up to parallel ports, the serial port is often used for modems, plotters, and input devices such as a light pen. Each device has different serial requirements. The Amiga operating system provides a simple and easy to use method of making these changes. Simply select Change Serial and a window will appear with a number of options in it. The baud rate determines the speed with which information is transferred. For example, a modem transfers information at 300, 1200, or 2400 bits per second. If you are hooking one Amiga to another, you may be able to transfer data at 9600 BPS. To make a change, click the selection button while the pointer is on either the up or down arrow. The other options include the read bits, stop bits, write bits, parity, handshaking, and buffer size. If these terms seem foreign to you, don't worry. As you begin to use the computer and the peripherals more, you'll learn what each one does. To give you a brief overview, here are some of the basic explanations for each option. If you don't like the colors of the workbench, you can change them using this tool in Preferences. You can select the color you want changed and then move the three slider gadgets back and forth to create a new color. The gadgets are marked R for red, G for green, and B for blue. Once you've changed the colors, you can recall the previous settings by selecting Reset Colors. You can also reset the workbench colors to their factory preset condition by selecting the Reset All gadget. Many computers do not offer the ability to display interlaced information. As we've mentioned, the most common form of interlace is in your television set. The value of changing colors becomes more apparent when using interlaced displays. On some monitors, an interlaced display will appear to flicker. One of the most important things that you can do with preferences is to install the proper printer driver. Each printer has different characteristics that need to be used to get the most out of the Amiga and the particular printer you've selected. Select Change Printer to open the Change Printer screen. The most important and commonly used functions are at the top of the window. The printer can be connected to either the parallel or serial port. Today, most printers use parallel connections. In the upper right-hand corner, you'll see an up and down arrow and a scrolling list of printers. These are pre-designed printer drivers for some of the most popular printers on the market. To install the driver for your printer, simply scroll through the list until your printer appears. If you can't find a listing for your printer, select Custom for the listing. If you just want to print text, you can select Custom from the printer listing and then type in the word Generic in the Custom Printer Name gadget. If you want to create a complete custom printer driver, you can create one using the other gadgets on the screen. You can adjust the paper size, the margins, the paper type, the quality of printing, the pitch, and the spacing of the type to be printed. You can also select from a number of graphics options. Select the Graphics Select gadget and the graphics window will appear. The most important option is in the lower left-hand corner of the window. This is the Shade option. If you select color, the only other option in the window that needs any attention is the aspect option. With aspect, you can print either vertically or horizontally. If you select black and white or grayscale, you can also adjust the image and threshold of the blacks, whites, and grays. When you select the Edit Pointer gadget, you will see the pointer editing window. Some people may prefer to have an object other than an arrow for a mouse pointer. The window includes all of the options required to create your own custom pointer. You can create any color you like using the RGB sliders. This works in much the same manner as adjusting the workbench colors. Note that the far right color option is transparent. To actually change the shape of the pointer, select one of the colors and click the selection button where you want the change to take place. If you click in an area not currently a part of the pointer, the color you've selected will appear. If you drag or click over the current pointer, the new color will appear. To erase the current pointer, select Transparent and drag over the shape of the current pointer. Every pointer has a hot spot. This is represented by a single pixel in a different color from the rest of the pointer. To change the hot spot, select Set Point and click the mouse where you want it to be. Once you've made the changes you want to preferences, don't forget to select either Use or Save. Remember that Use will allow you to use the settings you've selected until you reset the computer. Save will keep your changes intact until you decide to change them again. The Amiga has been designed as a flexible tool for use in educational, productivity, and business applications. In order to meet the needs of such a diverse audience, certain parameters were designed into the Amiga to accommodate as many users as possible. All models of Amiga computers are expandable. The original Amiga 1000 still has many peripheral devices available for it. The Amiga 500 series, or what we call the Compact series, utilizes an integrated keyboard and disk drive in the CPU. Also included is an expansion port on the left-hand side of the computer. If you're interested in adding a large number of peripherals, then you should consider using the Amiga Component series, including the Amiga 2000, 2000 HD, 2500, and the new 3000. These Amiga systems offer a separate keyboard and a series of expansion slots specifically designed for adding peripherals. Perhaps the most common thing to add to your Amiga is memory. There are a number of third-party memory boards around that work quite well. Memory is useful if you're creating animations or working with large databases. If you're using the Amiga for anything other than basic operations, a minimum of 1 megabyte is recommended. If you're working with more than one program at a time and are using the Amiga's multitasking capabilities, you should consider 2 to 4 megabytes. The Amiga will support up to 8 megabytes of memory. Let's insert a memory board into an Amiga 2000 series computer. First of all, the case of the CPU must be removed. When working with the screws on the CPU, be extra careful. It's easy to strip the screw guides, which in turn will cause you great frustration. Once the case is off, you can see what the interior of the Amiga 2000 looks like. There is the 68000 processor, the special chips developed by the Amiga group, including the famous Agnes or Fat Agnes chip. There are also edge connectors for both Amiga and PCXT expansion boards. The memory expansion board we're using utilizes an Amiga connector. Holding the board on both sides, carefully slide it down toward the connector. Make sure the connector is properly positioned. It's easy to reverse the position of the board, so be careful. Once the board is properly positioned, press down evenly on the top of the board. You'll feel a satisfying click when the board is completely seated into the connector. Now, replace the cover of the CPU, and you're in business. A second disk drive is really one of the most important peripherals that you can add to your system. For the Amiga 500 series, you will have to add an external disk drive. As we mentioned earlier, the Commodore drive is quite good and is readily available through your authorized Amiga dealer. There are also a number of drives available from third-party manufacturers as well. Some of the third-party drives offer a slimline appearance, taking up less room and providing a pleasing look. If you have an Amiga 2000, you can add up to 2 internal drives, plus a drive for IBM software. Ask your dealer for availability and pricing. A hard disk will allow you to run many programs without having to constantly change disks. A typical hard disk contains over 20 megabytes. That's more than 25 floppies. You can buy hard disks with up to 300 megabytes. Most people are happy with a hard disk system that uses somewhere between 20 and 60 megabytes. If you own an Amiga 2000 or 3000 series computer, you have the option of adding an internal hard disk system. There are two components to an internal disk system, the hard drive component and the controller card. This card snaps into one of the Amiga expansion slots and controls the information going to and from the drive.
External drives are in self-contained boxes, often including the controller system. All you need to do is plug the drive cable into the proper plug on your Amiga and plug the hard disk power into the wall. The Amiga will treat the hard disk in the same manner as a floppy. An icon will appear on the desktop and you can easily drag anything you want to copy to it. Whereas floppy drives are referred to as DF0 or DF1, hard drives are called DH0 or DH1. Newer Amigas will have the proper kickstart ROM in them and thus allow you to boot directly from the drive without inserting a floppy version of Workbench. If you can't do this with your Amiga, consider upgrading to version 1.3 or 1.4 of the kickstart and Workbench. Your Amiga dealer will have the details.
Digitizers allow you to import graphical information into your Amiga. There are a number of different digitizers available. There are two ways to digitize information into the computer. First of all, you can use a camera and photograph the information. Secondly, you can use a VCR and capture video information. As you can see, the results can be quite spectacular. A digitizer is a valuable tool for the graphic artist or advertising designer. Video is one of the primary capabilities of the Amiga. A Genlock allows the Amiga to generate a computer signal and sync it perfectly with a composite video signal. You would use a Genlock for superimposing titles on live video or for matting a computer image like this one with some actual video footage. There are a number of Genlock devices available for the Amiga. Once the Genlock is connected, simply feed the computer signal onto the video signal. The results speak for themselves. Your Amiga should be treated like any other important piece of equipment. Try not to drop it or smash it with your roofing hammer. Even more importantly, don't let dirt and dust accumulate on your system. Wipe the unit with a clean, soft cloth. Don't use paper toweling for the computer itself. You can use a cleaner, but be careful not to use anything too abrasive. The monitor can be cleaned with Windex or any household window cleaner. You may use a paper towel for this, but be careful not to scratch anything. If you aren't going to use the computer for an extended period of time, it's a good idea to cover it with a clean cloth to prevent dust buildup. Don't let the Amiga sit in direct sunlight. If the sun passes by your window for an hour or so, that may be okay. But don't put the Amiga any place where the sun can beat in on it for hours. If you do, then you may return to find the plastic has responded to the sun and it is now in the shape of Lake Erie. The heat can also damage electronics inside of your Amiga. One of the peripherals most likely to act up is the mouse. Since it has a roller in it, dirt and dust will accumulate inside the mechanism and cause its performance to falter. The mouse is easy to clean. Turn the mouse over with the cable facing the ground. Using both hands, press lightly with your thumbs over the two arrows on either side of the mouse and push towards the end of the mouse. The cover will open and you can then remove it by using a fingernail. Turn the mouse over again and the mouse ball will drop out. It's a good idea to have the ball drop out into your hand instead of onto the ground. Looking inside the mouse opening, you'll see three metal rollers. If they are bright and shiny, they aren't dirty and you can reassemble everything. Usually after several months of operation, though, they will look grimy with black lines around them. Use a cotton swab, moistened with tape recording head cleaner, to clean the roller surfaces. Be careful not to get lint from the swab trapped onto the roller. Once you've completed cleaning, blow gently into the opening to remove any last traces of dust or lint. Using a dry cloth, wipe the mouse ball to remove any dust or lint, then replace everything, and you're right back to work. The Amiga has been designed as a powerful multitasking computer. Commodore has also put quite a bit of effort into making the Amiga easy to use. As you've been learning, the workbench allows a variety of computer operations to take place by selecting and controlling a series of on-screen icons. For the more experienced user, there is another method of controlling the functionality of the Amiga. It's called the Command Line Interface, or CLI. The CLI allows you to give instructions to the Amiga directly through the operating system, Amiga DOS. Once you've learned a bit about its use, you'll be able to control the Amiga using a combination of CLI and workbench commands. Get to the CLI. Check to make sure that the CLI gadget in the Amiga Workbench Preferences program has been switched to on. Once set, you'll see an icon for the CLI in the system drawer under Workbench. Double-click the mouse over the icon and a CLI window will appear. It will be titled New CLI Window. Once the CLI is loaded, you'll notice a little caret in the upper left corner of the screen. This is the command prompt. To execute any command while in the CLI, you must type in the command and then use the return key. Commands may be typed in either upper or lower case, but the proper use of syntax is critical to successful CLI operations. Now, let's try a simple CLI operation. We'll create two CLI windows. This will prove useful later on when multitasking. Type in new CLI after the caret in the CLI window and hit return. Instantly, a new CLI window will appear with a 2 before the caret. If you pull the window down, you'll see the first CLI window beneath. To close the second CLI window, type in NCLI and hit return. The same command closes window number 1. One of the most important functions to learn is copying disks. The process is simple and it will give you a good idea of the command structure used in CLI. To copy a disk, you'll need to have a CLI window open and two disks. For this example, let's copy a workbench disk. If you have a single disk drive, you will type in disk copy from DF0: to DF0: This command is telling the computer to copy one disk to another using the DF0 disk drive. If you have two disk drives, you will type in disk copy from DF0 colon to DF1 colon. This is telling the system to copy from the internal drive to the external drive. If you wanted to copy a disk in the other direction, simply reverse the drive order. Once the disk copy program is initiated, all you need do is follow the instructions. Once complete, you can use the copy of your workbench disk and put the master in a safe place. If something should happen to the disk you use, you'll always have the master available as a backup. Often, you'll want to create a series of disks that you can add data to at any time. As disks are designed for a variety of computers, they have no formatting on them when you purchase them. So formatting is a process that prepares a disk to receive information for the specific computer you're using, in this case an Amiga. The format command is simple. Type in format drive DF0 colon name blank disk. The blank disk could be any name. Another important command is labeling a disk. If you want to take an existing disk and give it a new name, this command is the preferred method. For this example, insert the disk into the internal drive. This disk is named Stuff, so we'll change the name to Data. Type in relabel Stuff colon space Data. The previous examples have been many system programs designed to work within the operating system. We call these programs system software or software utilities. There are many direct commands in the operating system that perform single functions. A perfect example is the directory command. When you use the workbench, you were able to see the icons for the various programs and data files on a disk. The CLI required a command to list the information on a disk. Type in DIR and press the return key. A listing of files will appear in the CLI window. Note that some of the files have an open parenthesis and the letters DIR followed by a closed parenthesis. These are directory files. They are often shown along with drawers or other icons in the workbench mode. You can be more specific when using the DIR command. For example, if you want a directory of the external drive, type in DIR DF1 colon. Another variation of the DIR command is the list command. The list command will provide more detailed information on the files in a disk. Type in list DF0 colon. The CLI window will display a listing of the files on a disk, the size of the files, the type, the date, the time of creation, and information on whether it can be deleted. Just as you could use the DIR command to list information on a specific disk, the list command can be used to list information on a specific directory. Type in list C. The CLI window will display information on the files within the C directory. You can modify the file capabilities using the protect command. For example, assume you've created a file you don't want erased. You can prevent accidental erasure of the file by using the protect command. Type in date caret the file. Protect the file, list the file. You've told the computer to protect the file from deletion. The command for deleting a file is delete. If you type in delete the file, watch what happens. The CLI window displays a message telling you that that file cannot be deleted. Let's activate the file again by typing in protect the file, R-W-E-D. Now if you type in delete the file, it will be erased from the disk. It's important to be able to get information about the file system. The info command provides valuable information about the disk file system. Type in info. The CLI window will display information about the files on the disk, including the size of the files, their read-write status, if there are any errors, and how much space is taken up on the disk. One of the nice things about the Amiga operating system is the flexibility it provides for tracking information and files. When we used the workbench, you may remember we used drawers to store information. When using the CLI, these drawers are known as directories. Notice that when you look at the contents of a disk in the workbench mode, you'll see a variety of names, including system, empty, and so on. When you ask for a directory of the disk using the CLI, you'll see the letters DIR in parentheses next to those same files. That's the indication that you are listing directory files instead of program or data files. Having different directories is very important when using a computer system. You don't want a chance that you're going to confuse your tax files with your game files. So certainly having different directories is important. Changing from one directory to another is pretty easy. The directory system in the CLI is broken down into the root or main directory and subdirectories. To see where you are, you can type in CD. The CLI will respond with a line telling you which directory you are in. In this case, the response DF0: means you are in the root directory. To change to the C directory, type in CD space C. To change to another disk directory, type in the disk name after the C. For example, type in CD DF0: It's fast and direct. You can also move up and down through the directory structure. As you may have figured out, you can create directories inside of other directories. To move down into the directory structure, type in the directory name you want. To move up, you can either type in the name you want, or you can type in CD/. The slash will move you up one directory level. Obviously, you need to know how to create a new directory in order to take advantage of the CLI filing capabilities. Using the command make dir, you can create a directory. Type in makedir space my drawer. Now type in the directory command and voila, the new directory name will appear. The CLI includes a date command for setting the date and time. To see what the current setting is, type in date and hit the return key. The CLI will respond with the current date and time setting. Now, let's change the date and time. We'll type in date 0930 hours 01 December 1990 and hit return. The new information is now stored. And if you've got a battery clock card or an external option for your Amiga, the date and time will continue to be stored even when the Amiga is turned off. If you don't have the clock feature in your system, you might need to reset the clock and date each time you use the computer. For most operations, the date and time are not important to the operation of the various programs. CLI commands are usually designed to work with the screen of your Amiga monitor. You can change the direction or output of any command by using the caret command. We've already demonstrated this command once when we discussed the protect command. For example, since we've just explained using the date command, let's experiment a bit. Remember what happened when you typed in date and the return key. The date and time appeared on your screen. Now let's type in date, caret, date file, and return. The date and time do not appear on the screen. Why not? Since you redirected the command to a file named datefile, the information was written to a data file on your disk. To see the contents of the file you just created, you'll need to use the type command. Type in type, datefile, and return. The file will display the date and time. You can use the type file for any text file on any disk. You can change the name of the file by using the rename command. For example, let's change the name of the file we just created. Type in rename from date file to today. Now, if you use the directory DIR command, you'll see that the date file has been replaced by today. If you use the type command, you'll see that the contents of the file are the same. Now, if you want to get rid of the file, you can, using the delete command. Let's get rid of the file named today. When using the workbench, you can drag files to the trash. With the CLI, type in delete today and return. The file is now gone. To check, use the DIR command. If you delete a file, you will not be able to retrieve it using any workbench or CLI commands. You can copy files using the copy command. With a two-disk system, simply type in copy from DF0: file name to DF1: file name. Sometimes, it's more convenient to use a portion of the memory as a disk drive. This section of memory is referred to as a RAM disk. Once created, it looks and acts just like a floppy disk drive, except that it responds much faster. However, once you turn the power to your Amiga off or reset the computer, the RAM disk and all of the data contained within it are history. To create a RAM disk, type in DIR RAM colon and press return. The disk drive light will go on for a moment. After it goes out, your RAM disk will be ready to go. If you go into the workbench, the RAM disk will appear on the desktop just like any other disk. When using the CLI, you can access the RAM disk using the same commands as any other disk drive. Because the Amiga is a multitasking computer, you can perform several functions at the same time. You can also have multiple operating environments, including CLI windows. To create a new CLI window, type in New CLI and return. The new CLI window will look just like the first one, except the caret will be preceded by a number 2 instead of a 1. Each CLI window takes up memory, so you may run into trouble if you keep trying to open up CLI windows with limited memory. To activate a CLI window, click the left mouse button once in the window you want to use. To close a CLI window, simply type in End CLI from the command line within the window you want closed and hit the return key. The Amiga comes with a text editor called ED. This editor is more simplistic than a complete word processing program, but contains powerful commands for editing program source code and for creating data files. There are two groups of commands available to you when using ED. The first group involves a series of keys on the Amiga. The commands include using the up arrow, down arrow, left and right arrows, the tab key, the return and backspace key. As you can see, it's quite simple to move around in a file. If you use the escape key, you will activate a second group of extended commands. The extended commands will not function until you press the return key. These keystrokes are always combined with the escape key and include Q for quitting without saving the text, SA for save, SH for display of editing data, T for moving to the top of the file, and X for save the data and quit the program. Every time you boot your Amiga, it will look for a startup sequence file. On your workbench disk, this file can be found in the S:\ directory, S meaning startup. The startup sequence will tell the Amiga where to allocate memory, disk drives, and so on. You can make changes in the startup sequence using the ED editor. As an example, let's take a look at the startup sequence on your workbench disk. By the way, as startup sequences are often and easily changed, the actual sequence on your workbench may be slightly different than our example. First, load a CLI window. Type in the command to load the startup sequence into the editor. ED space S slash startup hyphen sequence. Find the command Use Preferences Tool to set date. Now, click the selection button at the beginning of the line after it and type in DIR RAM colon. Now save the file. Once complete, reset your Amiga. You'll see an additional disk icon on the workbench screen. This is the new RAM disk you've asked the Amiga to create each time it starts up. As you become more familiar with the Amiga, you'll find a number of uses for the startup sequence. The easiest thing to do with damaged disks is to throw them away. However, before doing so, it's a good idea to make sure the problem isn't related to the data on the disk. To do this, copy the file or files to another pre-formatted disk. Then check the operation of the data on the new disk. If the data doesn't work, you can work with the files using one of the various file doctor programs available through your local dealer or user group. But if the files do work, you may have a defective disk. Prior to terminating the disk, format it as if it was new. If it formats okay, then the disk is probably free from defects. If there is anything dramatically wrong with it, the formatting process will fail. Remember, if you have any doubts, throw the disk away. This is also a good time to mention backups. Whenever working with software, the golden watchword is, don't forget to back up your work. It's amazing how many people familiar with computers do not back up their work. Eventually, all of these folks will pay the price with lost data or programs, guaranteed. Backing up your programs and data is cheap insurance against wear and tear. Copy protection is coded into various programs to prevent the unauthorized duplication of software. This form of duplication is called piracy by the computer industry, and it is a crime. Unfortunately, copy protection can complicate the use of certain software programs. You may be prevented from running the program from a hard disk or from the Amiga RAM disk. Most productivity software isn't copy protected any longer. There are some programs that are, and most games include some type of protection. If you're worried about copy protection, check with your dealer before purchasing the program you need. One of the most important things to prepare for when using software is the computer virus. 10 years ago, if you'd have mentioned a computer virus, people would have called the Nuthouse Police. Today, unfortunately, computer viruses are an all too common problem. A computer virus is a program, often invisible to the common user, that embeds itself into the programs or operating system of a computer. Once embedded, the virus will cause loss of data, write false data to a disk drive, or incite other operational problems. The term virus is used because the pirate program will attach itself to any disk or program that it comes in contact with. Therefore, the most common way of receiving a virus is loading a program from a friend onto your hard disk or making a copy of it onto a floppy. So there you have it, a basic introduction to the operation of your Amiga computer. Don't forget that experimentation is a good way to continue your learning process. Good luck and happy computing.